Hello, everybody. This is Wani Angerere, Moving Cultures from Bangkok. Welcome to 30 Minutes Promoting Unity in Diversity. Our guest, number 63, is Moses Nyawanda from Kenya. How are you, Moses?
I'm fine, Wani. How are you?
Very well, Moses. Thank you. I know that you're having some problems connecting through Zoom, but we have you on the line from Kenya, and we are very happy to be sharing your talents with the community and with the people around the world. So, how is life, Moses?
Yeah, Wani, thank you for having me, and I must appreciate that you made the effort. We are having a bit of a problem with our Zoom, but we talk during
and
Kenya is okay.
Yes.
A bit of sunshine and cold, but then we are in it. That's been well.
Very good, Moses. Who is Moses Nyawanda?
Moses Nyawanda is an artist by profession. I was born in Kenya at a very remote place called Sumu. But I got brought up at a town called Kericho, and eventually landed in Nairobi. I grew up most of my time as an artist in Kericho, and in Nairobi I became a professional artist eventually. So right now, as we speak, I'm a professional artist. I paint myself, that's what I do.
Moses, what can you tell us about the influences in your art?
Well, the first time that I got influenced by art, and later on thinking of becoming an influence in art, was when I was still very young, in class three, I think. And I spent a teacher who recognized herself in what I was doing, and that became like an influence in what I'm doing right now. Because the fact that I was that young and I could recognize herself in what I was doing, that influenced my career. But as I continued, I did not pursue art as a career, because it wasn't in school or even in colleges. But later on, as I got to a college that was practicing art, and eventually I started painting, and what I'm painting has really been an influence on other people. Young people, young artists were coming up, and I tried to mentor. So my kind of painting are mostly my history, what I've gone through, and what I've been, and what my life has been.
So we will say that your work is autobiographical?
Yes, it is, because if you look at my work, you find that what I do is my life. It's like a record of what I've been doing, what people have been doing, what I've been doing, and sometimes I paint those that I've not done as a person, but have a memory. So if you look at my work, you'll find that they are, most of them are based on my tradition and the culture that I have had before as a young person, and what then the culture that I later on joined, especially in metropolitan where I came from.
There is a painting that I have at the moment on the screen that is called Two Cows and a Husband. What is the story behind this piece of art?
Well, that particular piece, I did it just 2 years ago. And the story behind it is you real or most of my work is that I sometimes I imagine things, and that particular painting is something that I was working on, especially the culture that is new to us Africans. So the two people, the three people standing on up there, there's one who is a man, two ladies,
mm-hmm.
and then there's a cow. You know, our tradition as African, we usually pay bride, and the bride that usually we pay dowry, sorry.
Mm-hmm.
And the dowry that usually pay is a cow. So that particular painting, the man wants to marry. So when a man wants to marry, then one thing that crosses his mind is about where will he get cows and to pay as a dowry.
Mm-hmm.
So at the end of it all, he gets a wife and marries and gets paid using cows. So in this particular painting, I was talking about a man who is tied to the economical factors that not able to afford two cows because he wants to marry two women.
Mm-hmm.
As you can see, there are two women having
okay, so it means
economical.
So he's in a trouble because he can only afford one wife.
Yes, he's in a dilemma sort of, but because he needs to get two wives, but he only has one cow. So there's that limit.
Uh-huh.
That is very in a sense, what I was trying to talk about is what men go through, especially when you want to acquire something and you can't afford it. But it's a need.
Mm-hmm.
That sense.
Okay, we have another painting that say the crocodile tears.
Yes, the crocodile tears. I did at the same time during the same time that I painted this about the other one that we just talked about. Is the in fact, I was talking about my culture as a individual where when a funeral happens, they cry a lot, and some don't cry, and they cry in order to make people feel that they are responsible, but they are not.
Mm-hmm.
So in this particular one, there's a particular wedding that I attended to. That I attended, and this was I was very interested in what was happening because I realized that they actually hired the job of crying so that people may feel that they are really sad, but they were not because it was a job that they paid for it, and this is happening now. It's new because. There's a lot of debt that has happened, and I think people are just finding ways of getting a way of earning money. And Crocodile Tears is one of them. Those the characters that are on that painting are showing three or so for people who are professionals and are doing that duty of
mm-hmm. trying for others.
Money out of it. Yes.
Okay.
Because they want to get money.
Okay, let's see the following piece. This one is called Still Waiting.
Yes, Still Waiting is a young lady who it's the topic of marriage. The character, the young people don't have this urge of getting married in the sense that they can't afford it. So we find that so many people, so many young men have not go for marriage because they fear
mm-hmm.
the fact that it's expensive and it's a bit and there's control. So ladies keep on waiting and waiting for so many years to find that at an age where they should marry, but they are not married because the young boys are not
mm-hmm. There is a comment of a lady that say it is very beautiful, but she wants to know why the hands are so small, so little.
Yeah, and it's also a painting that was talking about the characters of ladies who are working, they're in a position to work as they are employed.
Mm-hmm.
So they're career ladies. These career ladies have the reason why I put small hands was that they don't have a heavy task to work. That's just about the brain. They want to improve their skills. So at the end of the day, they don't use a lot of their energy to work. So this particular lady is a lady who is a professional lady and has been like those who would go to
the field.
Plow to the field, that plow, to the field to plow.
So this
that's
is
the reason why the hands are rather small.
Okay, so it means there is a woman that works in an office, they probably have to do desk work, work with the computer, but not necessarily to work on the land.
Yes, that particular one is talking about that particular woman.
That's the
woman who does not need to work very hard and sweat.
Yes.
To sweat over work so that they can put bread on their table.
There is another figure of four men with picks and four and five women on the bottom. What is this painting's name?
That painting is called Paying the Dowry.
Paying the Dowry.
Yeah. You realize most of my paintings are about relationships.
Mm-hmm.
And this one in particular is relationship between the four men and the five women. And now they're going to get married. Some will get married, one will not.
Mm-hmm.
And that is what is happening right now in Kenya and Africa in particular, and probably the whole world, where you find that the population of women are a bit higher than men. So you end up that when marriage comes, then you find that so many of the ladies do not get married.
Mm-hmm.
And that is the balance that is happening for us, that is not. It's not really good for us because for those who are talking about one woman, one wife, or one woman gets married to one man. So the balance is not really working.
Exactly.
At the moment. That's the reason why I put more ladies down there.
The men.
Up there are women, are men who wish to marry the four, but one with definitely
remain without a husband.
That's
there is another one they call is called Hide and Seek.
Yeah, Hide and Seek. There's three girls, three little girls, and they're playing hide and seek. If you look at their hands, they're holding on to something and they're hiding it. Some are hiding it. So the three are hiding. So they're playing. But the play is not as that one of children's play.
Mm-hmm.
It's about trust in the society. Mm-hmm. People hide a lot of things. People don't open up easily, and then even if they do, then they hide things. They can say something, but they don't actually mean. So you see that the three children, I use the three children because I love the innocence of the children, but I like to put it in such a way where they are also adults. When they reach adults, they tend not to. The innocence appears and people, and you can't trust any of them because everybody wants to get something out of the other, not necessarily in the right way.
Mm-hmm.
So they are hiding, each is hiding something. And that is our human
nature.
That's what the human race is all about. Mm-hmm. Nobody. Very few are saying the truth, apart from the children.
Exactly. The next piece is called Wedding.
The wedding. The wedding are just two ladies who are in, they're putting on a gown, both of them, and they are holding each other's hand.
Mm-hmm.
Now, that topic is very sensitive because in Africa, in that, hardly get, it's a culture that is coming up that really can, well, can get married.
Yeah.
So this is a topic that I want for the sake of those who are not aware that it is happening. So, but at the back of these two ladies, like I see, is not, there are two men hiding behind them. So those two men are as much as they would like to marry two ladies, they can't, because the ladies are getting married in each other. Controversial topic, and it is very open, and the wedding, as it is in the painting, is going on in.
So this is talking about same-sex marriages, you know, and raising awareness on this topic. Okay, let's see the next one. Okay, let's see. We have again. Okay, matters of the heart.
Of the heart is two young people who are in love. Actually, one is in love. There's a relationship going on between the two. But there's always that issue of one trying to play hard to get, that's that. And the man is really trying to think of what exactly to make the girl be happy. So if you look at the head somewhere, some element sort of that the man is wearing, there's a formula or something. Now, and then at the end of it, there's a question mark.
Yes.
Now, that, the man is really perplexed. He has given out everything. At the top of the painting, there's some flowers he has provided for the lady. The lady is still not happy. Other things for the ladies, but you see the lady is holding a red card. Look at the lady's hand.
Yes.
It means that she doesn't like the man. Even after all the effort that the man is
doing on her. Okay, let's go.
So in this particular painting, it's about finding the formula of getting to alert somebody that you like.
Exactly.
Getting the right button.
How can he reach the heart of the loved one?
Yes, exactly.
Let's see the next one. The next one is I think it's a man with glasses, a lady with some a hat, and it's a piece of paper with books on the table. I don't see the title of this one, Moses. It's a colorful piece.
I don't have it here with me.
Yeah.
So I'm not exactly.
Yeah. Let me move forward and see. There is also a lady with a face mask. Another ladies together in colors purple and red and yellow, but they're wearing face masks.
They're wearing face masks?
Yes. Yeah,
those are just some topic that I was talking about that people like each other. You don't even know what the other person is. They wear a face mask. The face is there, but then it's hiding under a mask. So at the end of the day, you may not know what it's about, suspicion, where somebody may tell you something that it doesn't mean. And then at the end of the day, when you discover it, probably too late. That is the society that you
know. Yeah, when I saw the face mask, I saw that the painting has something to do with the pandemic, with the COVID situation.
Yes, okay. We see those masks. Actually, that painting, there are some paintings, and this one, and also this one I did at last year when the pandemic was on. And that also inspired my kind of thought of, because the mask is a mask as it is, and it can mean anything, which means that even often the mask that is used to cover for the pandemic, but at the same time, it's actually covering something underneath, like the lips or the eyes or anything. So at the end of the day, a mask, is a symbol of deceit, of covering for something.
Okay, let's move to the next one. Then we have three ladies and three pair of foot. There is three ladies and some feet under. Three ladies sitting.
And under?
Yeah, three ladies, and there you can see some feet in front of them.
The feet
of a man, I think.
Those ones, actually, they are not ladies, they are actually men. And they're wearing the same type of clothes. That is, they're in uniform. But they're wearing ladies' shoes. And then they're carrying some things like a spanner, this is a needle, and all that. This is what is going on right now. There are some professionals who are carrying us. Their carriers, so they're like spanner boys.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
In the real sense, these are men who do not like to work. Mm-hmm. They stay at home while the women go out and work. So the shoes that they're wearing, women. Mm-hmm. In other words, they've taken the women for the work. They know ideas like us, man should go out and work, come back, and the woman should be at home. So it's the other way around.
Mm-hmm.
So these three men, they have careers, but they are not working towards the career. They are just staying at home while the women go outside to look for bread and then come. That is something that really works in Africa,
probably
particular. Where young men are not ready to work, they wait for their women to go and work at them. They just learn.
Moses, can you tell us about the colors you use in your art?
Yeah, I'm a colorist, and whenever I start painting, I do my sketch, which I'm not good at, but I really love to experiment with colors. When I start to color, I don't have a something in particular that I want to do. But then as I continue, like an inspiration sort of where I try and experiment and come up with different colors that are sort of not in existence. So most of my paintings have a lot of red colors. And they're also therapeutic.
Mm-hmm.
When you look at them, you will find that it gives you some peace of mind because they are bright and also it makes you feel some peace. That is what I the main character of paint is coloring. Coloring it makes me happy when somebody is getting happy about the color.
Mm-hmm.
So that is my primary goal in this career is to do brighter colors, and I work towards it.
Mm-hmm. It's also very bright that the people have so many colors, so they can be green, blue, yellow. So they don't have one specific color, right?
Yes, true. And I'm able to satisfy all those people. Because people have different tastes, people have different taste of color. So I go out there and I don't fear go into any color which I don't actually experiment. And some bravery that I can choose any color in the world and still come up with something that.
Your paintings really represent unity and diversity because they cover the life of people of so many different backgrounds and stories and in places. You also do paintings that are reflecting the life of the communities. There is this one with the Maasai people sitting facing the village.
Yes, that's true. As I started my career, even in this interview, I talked about that I was raised in different cultures because I was born in an area where that is different from where I was raised up and ended up to have a career in a different place, which has different culture. And that really influenced my career in the sense that when I paint, I find that I combine the cultures from where I was raised, I was born, where I was raised, and where I live right now. So it's I combine all these things, all these cultures, so that every person can identify something from my painting. And when I was talking about the coloring, who have different culture and they identify with that color. So in this sense, I'm using so many colors in order to put all these culture that are together so that and everyone, every culture gets out of
coloring. Yes, it's
that diversity.
Yes, because you cover topics about women, about marriage, about children, about elderly, about different behavior that communities are now dealing with, about the pandemic. You use also a lot of cubic figures like lines and squares.
Yes. Yeah, that's true. That's what I do. In fact, I do a lot of because I know that I need to reach most people in their various different cultural states. So my paintings cut across from children up to the elderly. Even the one painting that you just described, where there are some elders seated and looking at the. So it means that from children to young people, it cuts across to the young adults, even to the elder people. I try to bond them together with my art so that each and everyone be identified with what I do.
What will be your message for the new generations and the society in general?
Well, the new generation in particular, I mentor them somehow. And my way of mentoring is and specifically for those who are talented, is that you can use your talent to do anything. And that talent can, it's important to use it in a good way, in the right way, and even get to reach each and every person in some way or the other. And this means that you could, even if you are from different culture, you can still reach to some people who culture are different, and you can end up having given a message somehow. And my message is that if you are talented, work towards it, don't push it, but keep on doing what you are doing. At the end of the day, you shall have passed your message well. Each and every to all some parts of the world that they were those who are young.
Well, Moses, thank you so much for it being an inspiration for so many generations and also for so many people. Thank you for promoting unity and diversity through your artwork and your way of living. And keep shining the way of so many people. Thank you so much. Blessings, and hope to see you soon in the near future, Moses.
Thank you so much, Wendy. Thank you for having put being part of this young, dear, and even being they will remember that I'm also part of you.
Okay, thank you, Moses. See you soon. Bye-bye.
Bye.